Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait.
Welcome to Wrestling Mayhem Show 517. We're coming to you from Pittsburgh here, and it's April 26th. And we have, thanks to our Basic Sickness, basicsickness.com, for our intro.
Tell them who you are.
Oh, who I am. My name is Missy. I was getting to that. Thank you, Sorg. I'm Missy. This is my friend Katie.
Also known as Dudders.
Also known as Dudders. And that over there on the internets is my friend Jen. And we are the ladies of the Wrestling Mayhem Show, which means that each of us has a significant other, with exception to Katie, that is part of the show proper of the gentlemen. And you've seen Katie's face on here before, and you've also seen Jen's face on here before.
Yeah, Katie goes both ways. Guys show, girl
Katie,
show.
Katie does go both ways. And so we're giving a different spin on things tonight, and we're doing the ladies' takeover.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
The goal is to see how many times we can make Sorg just shake his head like, no. And we're already up the count. Wait, that'd be two, actually.
Yeah, this is two in less than a 5-minute span. We're off to a really good start, ladies.
Yeah, you know.
So, yeah. We are... If you're listening to us, you've likely found us through WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Otherwise, you can hit us up there. You can also hit us up at... Are you ladies ready for it?
Good times!
Good times!
At WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And we actually do have a couple of listener emails this week to participate in our ladies' takeover. Otherwise, you can hit us up at 412-206-WMS0, 9670 for you folks. And, of course, the usual Twitter, Facebook, and Google+. And we definitely want to take a chance to thank our Patreons, as mentioned at the top of the show. So we're going to be, again, ladies, are you ready for this?
Yep.
All right. Thanks to our awesome Patreons.
Bo Diggity.
Woo!
That's headshake number 3.
Yes. Of course, we've also got Antonio Garza, Ed Burke, and the ever-esteemed Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. You can also... Yeah, that is you.
That's why you're on the show.
This is pretty much why it is. We were like, yeah, Patreons.
Yeah, become a Patreon and you might be on the show too. What? You could be here with us.
Yes. We could make a spot right here for you.
I would be there, but...
You have kids.
Sorry. Okay, go ahead.
All right. Let's go ahead and just jump right in. I think that one of the biggest things that we need to start off with is one of the biggest news items that started out this week, and that is the death of Chyna. Such a young individual that I'm sure it hit all of us in a different way. Mm-hmm. But that was big news. So we're gonna start off the top of the show talking about that, especially since it's a ladies' takeover. I think it's fitting to give some tribute and homage to one of the standout women mm-hmm. in women's wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
I think do you want to just go into Riz's email?
Yeah, we can start off. This is what I was talking about. We have some listener submissions, and mm-hmm. and Riz sent us some email. So
yeah, we'll start with the Riz mail because it does get us into this conversation. Salutation, ladies, and of course Sorg. I know I normally start an email by screaming WMS, but it just doesn't feel right. I haven't done this in a very long time, and there are ladies around. Even though I am sure Sorg did just yell Bo Diggity and woo really loud for his Patreon supporter. Thank you for your support, sir. So instead of boring you with dribble drabble about nonsensities and BS, my question is, do you think that aside from criminal charges / mayhem, murder / so on, should a professional wrestler's legacy be tainted by his or her professional life? And so let's just start with that. Let's just start with that question.
Yeah,
there.
That makes sense.
Do you think what happens essentially away from the ring should impact whether or not essentially do they get into the Hall of Fame? I mean, personally with me, I think that looking at the Hall of Fame, you don't induct the person, it's the persona.
Yeah, I agree. And the other aspect of it is, I think you should look at what they've done in comparison to what their persona did. Mm-hmm. Do we think that we're going to see Chris Benoit in the Hall of Fame? Mm. Given the circumstances, very, very, very unlikely. Drug infractions and different things like that, on the other hand, slight criminal charges, you know, that's a different story. And especially since Chyna was on the up and up. I mean, she was teaching English as a second language in a different country. I mean, so she was getting her stuff together. I haven't really heard much about her in the news otherwise, you know, the last couple of years at least. Which I think says something as far as her turning her life around. So I think that, especially under the circumstances, it should be rated.
It should be the persona and not the person.
Yeah.
Jen, what do you think?
Oh, 100%. Because, I mean, it's two different. There's real life. And then there's being Chyna, and you know what I mean?
Well, then we're kind of contradicting ourselves right now, because we're saying about Chris Benoit not getting in. He didn't kill somebody in the ring.
No, but that's what I'm saying is, I think that obviously part of the individual, mm-hmm. Joni Lauer is part of Chyna. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just the way it is. The part of that in-ring aspect is part of you outside of the ring, and vice versa. But I think that some of the stuff that, you know, problems that Chyna had in her past, she was trying to overcome them, and she was trying to become a better person and do more with things as far as that was concerned. Chris Benoit, I mean, that entire situation was what wound up. That was his final act with things, and that was ultimately, he's not going to be able to come back from that. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's where the difference in it is that that's how it should be looked at in comparison. Plus, look at the severity of things. Mm-hmm. The Chris Benoit situation is far more egregious and horrible than stuff that Chyna's done. I mean, I'm not saying Chyna was perfect under any stretch of imagination, but in comparison, the stuff that Chyna did versus the stuff that Benoit was found out to have done, apples and oranges.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't it the concussions that affected him?
Okay, this is a wholly different tangent on me. But yeah. Real quick, the admitting it was the concussions forces the WWE to admit that they didn't take better care of their wrestlers. And I don't think they're ever going to admit that.
Yeah, they're never going to do that.
And I think, yeah, so we'll just lose.
For what it's worth, Eamon actually just added to the chat room that, you know, I agree with Missy. Thank you, Eamon. Pornography is nowhere close to as severe as a double murder suicide. Mm-hmm. And that's what I was going with, is that it should be a ratio comparison of what things are. And a double murder suicide is far more egregious in the eyes of the law than drug charges or, you know, pornography or whatever the case may be. I think that's the difference. And like what Katie just said, the WWE is never going to admit that that situation was their fault in any capacity. Period. End of story. Not going to happen.
Mm-hmm. All right. Let's go back to, Riz's email again. And if something later comes out of the legend in the Hall of Fame, does the WWE have the right to take him or her off the Hall of Fame?
Is that meaning Superfly?
I'm wondering.
That's what I'm wondering. Now, here's my question as far as that's concerned. And I don't have a whole lot of familiarity with other sports arenas. Do they take somebody? Do they take OJ out of like the Football Hall of Fame or anything like that?
I think they may have taken his bust out of.
Really? Uh-huh. Okay.
I'm not sure.
Because that's my question. If it's something that's done in other areas, you really can't unring that bell.
No, he is. He is still in the Hall of Fame. I apologize.
Okay.
Yeah. Still in the Hall of Fame. And I know up at in Buffalo, up at the stadium, his name is still up.
Yeah. I knew at the stadium it was.
In the ring.
But I wasn't sure elsewhere. But I think it's harder to unring that bell once they've been put into the Hall of Fame versus if they're looking to put someone in comparison.
Kind of like Ray Lewis.
Kind of, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know what's going to eventually happen with him.
No,
it's very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just an odd type of situation. Is we literally put these people on pedestals and mm-hmm. realize they're human and they make sometimes some horrible, horrible, horrible life decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And also, they have yes people around them.
Oh, absolutely.
That does not help at all.
No.
And Riz says, I'm actually conflicted by something. On one side, it's the WWE's Hall of Fame, and it's the company's way of showing appreciation for the brand that is WWE. Some of the people in there, because the company likes the person and not so much built for the fans, they get to do whatever the heck they want. They get their tapes, the WWE Network library grows, and everyone has a good time. I mean, I ask you, what was your favorite Carlos Colon match? Heck, the reason why Chyna wasn't in the eyes of the trips is that she was doing porn, which would hurt the image of the WWE. And yet Sunny is doing porn with her Hall of Fame ring on. Don't ask me how I know. I don't want to explain myself. We won't ask Riz. However, if it wasn't for some of the pioneers of that era, we would be celebrating Starrcade 2016 instead of WrestleMania 32. And some of them, like Warrior, Savage, Roberts, Hall, and presumably Chyna, were question marks due to their history with the company until they were A, better, or 2, it got too late. Until next time, follow me at Riz Plays Games on the YouTubes for reals. Riz Plays Games needs something. Riz.
No spaces in there.
No, there is no space.
That was a bunch of letters.
Like, I'm looking at follow meat.
I know, that's what I'm seeing. I know, follow meat, Riz. Mm, as in M-E-A-T, Riz.
Yes.
Riz likes meat.
Hey, now. But yeah, that's a lot of interesting...
Mm-hmm. Would you like my rant on this whole situation?
Yes, because actually, do you think Chyna's death will play a part in whether or not she will be inducted into the Hall of Fame?
Well, no, that's a different conversation.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
But as far as the porn thing goes, WWE and WWF have consistently sold women.
Oh, absolutely.
They have sold, you know, the image of the woman, the ideal woman. They've sold sex. Hell, you know, we had sex in the ring during the Attitude Era.
Yep.
And
that's how we started this show.
Yeah. And then
we've all come so far.
And then was like the WWE was, you know, we're doing these things. And then suddenly with Chyna, it became, you can't do porn. We have morals. And it was like, what the hell are you thinking? You can't just double back and say that. And like one of the coolest things about Chyna was not this pinup, beautiful woman in the WWE standards. That anybody, this larger than life human who was a woman could succeed in wrestling. And even like with the whole Playboy thing and porn, like, Riz, you know, Risen is porn. Hi, Riz. the WWE benefits from this. WWE benefits from their women being in Playboy. They benefit from them being in pornography because that still goes back to the WWE. And it's like, you can't pick and choose when you're gonna have standards and when you're gonna have morals.
I'm wondering is it just the porn or is it the porn plus the drug issues that she mm-hmm. had?
Well, what other
people? I think it's a combination because everybody's done crappy things. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, I want, you know, we have the thing going on right now with Hulk Hogan, right? Like, mm-hmm. you know, wearing a Hulk Hogan shirt is like wearing a Confederate flag. Some people just like, oh, that's the racist thing because he said whatnot. Have you heard the things the Ultimate Warrior said?
Yeah.
And he has an award at the Hall of Fame. You know, I mean, look up some of his talks he had in like the early 2000s that were very bigoted. Very, very homophobic.
Mm-hmm.
If that popped up in a TMZ tomorrow, you wouldn't see an award in 2017's Hall of Fame. So I think it's a combination of that. And is this a personal thing with Triple H? You know, is it some kind of awkward thing there? Either way, I think it's unfortunate. And I don't think it's enough to, we just celebrated a guy that was a pimp and objectified women in the Hall of Fame,
exactly,
as in The Godfather.
Exactly.
Now, is this the double standards versus men versus women?
Well, and here's... absolutely. Back, even as far as women is concerned, Riz made a comment about Sunny doing porn with her Hall of Fame ring on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so how could that be any different than Chyna doing porn? Like, that's my thing, porn is porn.
Is it the guy that she did the porn with, though?
Who's not currently in the Hall of Fame just yet? X-Pac is not in the Hall of Fame yet. Nor does he pop up a whole lot on WWE.
Always around.
Well, we, for what it's worth, we do have Eamon chiming in from the chat room as well. Many also speculate that porn was almost an excuse for them not to include her because the real reason was her backstage history with Triple H. If so, that is incredibly unfortunate.
Oh, of course. 100%.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So, I mean, at the end of the day, I think it comes down to the fact that there are some politics involved with it, just period in a story. It's going to be better for some people to be able to get that push. It's going to be better for other people to have it brushed under the rug. And that's unfortunately the way it's going to be.
Now, do you think, what was the second question? Does she get to the Hall of Fame now?
Well, and that's a really good question. We've offered valid reasons as to why she should be.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, will WWE look at it as a valid reason to induct her?
Another question is her family and her relatives and her friends going to want her in the WWE Hall of Fame? I mean, this is essentially a organization that totally turned their back on her and, you know, double middle fingers. And now
when she needed something the most.
Absolutely.
But if you put her in, you know, if they put her in the Hall of Fame, her family is only going to view this as, you know what, you're just promoting your brand. You're like, look how great we are. Which the WWE, and this is a sore sticking point with me, as you've probably heard on any of the other shows, is they are so like, look how great we are. Look at the great things we're doing. Like 10 years too late. Like, you are so far behind the times, like the whole divas versus women. And like, look, we're rewarding you with this. We've only been asking for this, you know, respect for how many decades, you know?
Thanks, Stephanie, for bringing us the Divas Revolution, for instance,
what
we've been joking about.
So it's a double-edged sword. I understand the WWE, it's a double-edged sword for them because they're not sure, you know, if we put her in, does it look like we're doing this? If we put her in, do we mean she's...
Well, and that's just it. Posthumously, are they backpedaling at this point? I mean, you're going to have people and naysayers thinking that.
I would love for them to induct her and her family be like, screw you all.
Yeah, and for what it is, Garza says, I think she will. And it's an escape since she can go in without having to have her in the actual ceremony.
Thanks, Steph. Thanks.
Yeah, they're a little bit behind us in the chat room. But I think that there are some valid questions. And I would like to see how it's going to play out because they literally could go either way with it. Do you have some more notes?
No, just
as you're looking at your papers.
Those are my notes here. No, those are my notes for later.
See, and Part of the other thing is, I have another notation in here, is from a lady's perspective. I was really hoping to get Britt's commentary on this since she is a ladies wrestler. How did Chyna help define women's wrestling? And I think that that's another aspect of what they should be looking at as far as inducting her.
Well, everybody here is a longtime wrestling fan, and at least has a little bit of the Attitude Era where Chyna came and made her mark. How did she influence you guys as fans watching this kind of thing?
For me personally, I've said before, I'm a huge Attitude Era fan, and just seeing this woman who could hang with the guys, who had, you know, whatever. She was not, like, in the back of DX. She was in the mix with DX. And I know later on we're going to talk about those moments that really make us think of Chyna, but when she mooned the crowd, yes. Like, when DX was splitting up, and that was just like, you know what? I can play like the rest of you, you know? And it was like... And it was such a, like I said, it's like such a moment that WWE could have ran with and really put in more of these actual women wrestlers instead of the fluff. And it's just, they didn't run with it. And it was, but I think that to see someone like hold her own like that and just, she was confident and she could just, she was massively just huge and she was so strong, but she was so agile. You know, like she could do moves that little teeny people could do. Like I know I'm a tall person and I can't do those moves. Because, you know, I just gravity fall hard. but she had the ability to do it.
It was almost, for me, it was almost that back at that time, it was okay to be a girl. Well, of course, it's okay to be a girl. But to be a girl, to like wrestling, and not for it to be, you don't have to be fluffy and girly girl. Mm-hmm. To like it.
Well, I. Or, I'm sorry, Jen.
You know, don't. You know what I mean?
No, I know exactly what you mean. And, okay. Like, I liked the fact that Chyna legit held the Intercontinental Championship,
mm-hmm.
The only female performer to do so. And I think that that was freaking amazing because she literally got in the ring. With dudes and then kick their asses.
Yeah.
But legit.
With Jeff Jarrett at No Mercy in Cleveland.
Yeah.
Yes.
The other thing is that like you were talking about with just her size and her massiveness, she could run with the boys.
Mm-hmm.
I was so super excited when Beth Phoenix came on the scene because I was like, oh my God, it's another Chyna.
Mm-hmm.
I hope they run with this. I hope they do something. Like she was not the little petite thing. Mm-hmm. She was, you know, she was something to be reckoned with. And it wasn't a comparison like, you know, that she was a heavy, fat chick type of thing. She was muscular. She was built. She was able to do stuff that, like Katie said, I could only dream of doing. And it was absolutely amazing.
From the chat room, Eamon saying it's amazing to think that in the summer of 99, the rumor was there were plans to make. For her to have the WWE Championship.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine how much the landscape of this business would have changed. You know, and recently we've been talking about, oh, would WWE do intergender wrestling these days? We're like, oh, they'd never do that. And realizing they did that. I forgot until her Hall of Fame induction, Jacqueline completely did intergender wrestling.
Absolutely.
You know, Chyna did too with the and was an intercontinental champion, you know.
And like taking it to a different perspective, I know that, Sark, you and I have had this discussion. We've had her on the show a couple of different times, but Serafini.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When they put her in a match against Angel Dust,
mm-hmm.
I find it difficult to buy that match, you know, as a wrestling fan, just because of the size difference and the logistics involved with it. I'm not saying it's not possible, but Chyna, in comparison to the Attitude Era Divas, there really wasn't any comparison.
She towered.
Yeah, which made more sense for her to be able to take on the guys, which again, I think added a different aspect of there's so much more we could do with her.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of the same aspect that they did with Santino and his
mm-hmm.
counterpart there.
We've had that for a while. We've had that side.
Absolutely. Why can't we do
our Andy Kaufman's, our Harvey mm-hmm. Whippleman's, and our Santina Morella's for a while. Doing the intergeneral, I'm going to be the women's champion kind of thing. So, again, it's a size thing.
Well, we had one of the good matches she actually had with a woman was Lita on Judgment Day.
Oh, yeah.
And it was... Lita's one of my other favorite mm-hmm. divas. And because she...
She flies.
There's something about when you look at a wrestler, male or female, that you can look and go, man, that person would kick my ass in a fight.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of wrestlers you look at and you're like, I don't buy it. But like either one of those two, it was a good match for each other. And I thought it was exciting. You know, that was one of the fun matches to watch. And because they, you know, even though Chyna was bigger, Lita had finesse. She had her an arm bar, you know, it was like the that kind of stuff. And
yeah,
But like you said, there wasn't many women that, at that time. And the solution should have been bring more women in like Chyna. Don't dumb her down into a different character. Elevate everybody up.
And you know what? They tried.
Mm-hmm.
They did try. There was, I don't know if anybody remembers briefly, a Nicole Bass that was in there. It was for a mere couple of weeks.
Yeah.
There's definitely been attempts to repeat the Chyna effect, but not everybody was as good as Chyna too.
No,
so. No. And that makes a big difference. Like, you just showed a picture with Lita and I think it was Trish Stratus. Watching Lita in the ring, watching Trish Stratus in the ring when Trish first started out, like, I understand green wrestling, don't get me wrong.
Mm-hmm. But and Trish was one of those that came in as a model.
Yeah.
Was hired as a good looking model.
Exactly the way she looked.
But then was taught.
Yes.
Then they tried to repeat that. And that's how we got this dumbed down Divas division that was the bathroom break for so many years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's like Alex is putting in the chat room. I remember WrestleMania X7. Women's title match between Chyna and Ivory. To this day, I'm kind of amazed at how short that match was. I think that, you know, Chyna and Ivory could have been, I agree, it could have been longer. It could have been played out. If that match would have happened today with the revolution they're doing with the Divas, well, with the women's wrestling division now, not Divas, I think that it could have done, oh my God, I agree, it could have been so much better. Nicole Bass actually killed Chyna's gimmick. She was bigger and suddenly Chyna felt like less of a wonder. That's interesting.
Yeah, because, I mean, she was the only one. So
yeah.
They were the 8th or 9th wonder. I forget what they built her as.
Yeah.
That definitely makes sense.
Mm-hmm. So. Interesting. Okay. Well,
it's time for a pizza break.
I think it is time for a pizza break. Sorg. Share some pizza.
Yes, it's our good friend Slice on Broadway. We've been supporting the show for a good while, feeding our in-studio guests that make it in here on Tuesday nights for podcast day. Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza in Pittsburgh, now at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Thank you so much to them. You can check them out, like I said, here on the tracks in Beachview, or they got other locations at Carnegie, PA, or like I said, PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Get your slice when you're down there at the game. Or if you happen to work on the north side, cross a bridge, damn it, and go get some, okay? A lot of you guys work downtown, visit downtown, or maybe check out a play or something, or in the cultural district. Rico and the guys, great crew down there. Treat us so great down there. Even when we're not there for our sponsor pizza, we go hang out because it's the place to be. And they got a really cool layout. They got a really cool menu and great ingredients. And sometimes, you know, some of us we'll go order the Pizza Hut and everything that came in the frozen box that they slapped together. This is different. This is if you want a real pizza, go over to Slice on Broadway. Check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_Slice on the Twitter, Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and the Instagram. Tell them the Mayhem Show sent you. Missy?
Oh, hey, we're back. Thanks for that. Thanks for that nice little plug, Sorg.
I don't have any pizza.
Well, if you had been in the studio. I love how that was just kind of a chorus thing.
Yeah.
You guys carry on. I'm watching that Ivory and Chyna match from WrestleMania.
Well, that's okay, because Bobby put in Chyna versus Karma in her prime would have been amazing. Whoa. And I could not agree more. So I just had to bring that up. But we actually have some additional mail. And I want to get this in before we get lost in more discussion with some of our other topics here. But from Mad Mike. Greetings, ladies. It's that guy who gets kicked out at ladies night, but still had a great time at the NXT fight. It's Mad Goddamned Mike. Okay, so we have Payback this weekend. And the way I see it, the main event can go down one of three ways. One, the Bullet Club can show up and help AJ, and either he wins the belt or he sets up a big match at Ladybug Sex, formerly known as Extreme Rules, with Roman and his cousins.
Wait, what?
Ladybug Sex.
Ladybug Sex.
Why is it called Ladybug Sex?
And we'll have to ask Mad Mike. Number two, the Bullet Club turns on AJ and helps Roman win.
I'm sorry. The ad is Ladybugs having sex. Like, literally, that's the
first thing. Oh, okay. I forgot about that. Yeah. Right. Oh, my God, yeah. Why? Right.
For extreme rules?
Yes, it's now Ladybug sex.
Okay, Ladybug sex is now explained. Yes. The Bullet Club turns on AJ and helps Roman win, thus cementing the heel turn he has been teasing. Three, Gallows and Anderson come out and AJ doesn't know why they are there, and all of a sudden Finn Balor shows up with them and the match ends in a no contest with the Balor Club standing tall and holding the title hostage. My question to you lovely ladies is, what would you prefer?
I think we just got an answer from Jen.
White Alchemist ending transmission, and yes, I agree with Jen just because I like the Balor concept.
What do you think, Jen?
I like the Balor. But if the Bullet Club comes out and helps Roman, technically, isn't that a Shield 2.0?
Ooh.
Yeah, I was contemplating that.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have Roman.
But if they come and help Roman, is Roman then just part of the Bullet Club?
I think it becomes something else.
Probably not, because anywhere you stick Roman Bullet
Shield.
What?
It becomes Bullet Shield. I was just renaming the faction.
What if, let's pretend. So Roman gets his heel turn, because everybody hates him anyways. Why not make him a heel? Does that open the door for, what's his face to become, what's the blonde guy? Shield brain broke. Help me.
Ambrose?
No.
Seth.
Does that open the door for Seth become a baby face?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, the door is open.
That was the door.
Is that what that sound is?
Well, Garza's chiming in. No way in hell Reigns drops the title after he finally got his WrestleMania win. And Bobby says, I'd just like to let whatever happens happen on Sunday.
I want somebody to hold a title hostage.
Carson follows up. I think we're all overestimating WWE creative here.
They can't stretch this over several months.
No, they're not going to kill
the momentum, you know?
Between that and the number of injuries that they've had, you can't guarantee that somebody's not going to be out with a freaking injury these days. And you also have the other aspect of people are coming back from injuries. Cena just mentioned that his 9-month is shortened. He's due back sooner than what they had anticipated.
Memorial Day.
Yeah.
Well, that's
Memorial Day's coming back.
But that's also John Cena.
Well, Ladybug sex day.
True, but
hey, he's got to get good for that total Bellas.
No.
Yes.
We are not talking total. No.
No.
We are not talking that on this show.
No.
No.
Wow.
No.
Wow.
There's
really?
So much wrong.
Really?
So much wrong.
Okay. We'll spin back into this conversation in a few minutes.
No, we won't. We're not talking Bellas.
No, and that's just it. There is a difference between Divas, which I feel the Bellas are, versus Lady Wrestlers, which I believe other people are.
Okay, then we do what goes.
Total Lady Wrestlers, new show on E.
We'll get into this discussion a little bit later, but I want to continue since we're talking about options coming up for Payback. I wanted to get into some talk about Payback, because obviously that's a couple days away now, and I'm sure that we've had
opinions on everything.
Oh, Katie is literally pulling up her piece of paper. She has opinions. Oh my God, she has opinions.
Yeah, every right. Let's do it. Every match.
Also say Payback, if I just want Dean Ambrose to actually finish a match, possibly win, be topless, not have any freaking demonic children interfere or any of the Wyatts. I just want him to win. And Chris Jericho should not be wearing low-rise skinny jeans. That's all.
Okay, so Jen has become our Eamon for the segment.
How much? I mean, come on. They're making him look like a freaking wuss. I turned Raw off last night.
Oh, that Dean Jericho segment pretty much made me want them to both lose the ability to speak. I'm pretty good at never.
God, the funniest thing Ambrose said was when he said about with your Bon Jovi haircut.
Yeah.
I giggled. And then they're making him look like a total moron.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah, I totally agree. I could, but both of them could go away right now.
I can tell you this. I sat down with Sorg last night during Raw, which is something that I normally don't do because I've not been happy with Raw, mm-hmm. and I've not wanted to watch it.
This is the first time in a long, long time.
The most exciting aspect that I had with Raw last night was the very intro segment with Shane and Steph. And then the rest of it, I was working on other stuff and would periodically look up. The segment that you guys are talking about with, I can't even think of the people at this point.
Dean and Jericho.
I was just like, this is it. I shut down my computer and I went to bed at that point.
That's when I...
Like, I legit had no interest. None whatsoever. That's
when I went to bed. I was done. Mm-hmm. I was like, this is stupid.
Yeah, and I was like, oh, this quote-unquote, and I'm going to use quotes because it was on the website, new era.
Yeah, I'm like, whatever.
I'm like, come on, guys. You're just going back to the same suckiness. Stop it.
Yeah, so, all right. Let's get to Katie's rundown because I'm right. curious about the sheet over
all
here.
All right. I'll start from the bottom. Kalisto versus Ryback. Who the hell cares?
Pretty much.
Didn't even justify to be an actual match on any show.
Mm-mm. For two shows in a row.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What the hell? You suck. How bad do you suck to do this twice?
This is how much talent they have out with injuries right now.
Yeah, no kidding.
This is what they're billing. That's my thought on it, seriously, is mm-hmm. they have too many injuries.
I'm just also sad the U.S. title once again is on the kickoff show.
Yeah.
After we did so much with it with John Cena to build the title last year, and this is where it's at. So. Mm-hmm.
All right, and then Enzo and Cassidy versus Vaudevillians. I can't wait. That's going to be such a fun match.
Yes, oh my God.
I absolutely love Enzo and Big Cass.
If that match falls on its face in any capacity, I am going to lose all hope in main roster booking. Because the way that they've been building it, the in-ring spots and everything is like that, I've just been like, this I could get behind. I was kind of upset when I saw them in the ring and they came out and they were doing their back and forth and it didn't actually turn into something because obviously they're building up for the pay-per-view. I get it. But I was like, oh, I have to wait.
I know. I was like,
All right. Ziggler versus Corbin. I didn't even bother to write notes about because, again, don't care.
Don't you say anything bad about Baron Corbin.
No, but I'm so over Ziggler that I just don't care about this match.
Like Ziggler is the guy to make him look good very, very, very obviously.
Yeah, that's what Ziggler is.
Ziggler is the modern day CM Punk.
What?
Make everybody look good.
Right, right, except...
The new guy's coming up, make him look good.
Right, right, except he will never have his pipe bomb moment.
Mm-mm. Yeah, no, that's... Yeah. He's going to be stuck at that level, just, yeah.
Sorry. No. Okay, then Dean Ambrose versus Jericho. I vote that we change the match to Loser Never Speaks Again, because they've made this thing so ridiculous. We already went over why.
And it had been good up until now, I thought, mm-hmm. between those two.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just, I feel like they're shoving it down our throats, and they're just being stupid about it. No offense, Jen, but Ambrose, I've not been a fan of Ambrose as of late, just because, like, Katie made the comment, I think, on our pre-show thing, that he just seems to be taking all of these, like, character development and doing it all at once, and it's just not working in any capacity.
I don't think that's all him, though. I think there's a lot of stuff he's being told to do.
Probably. Oh, no, and I agree with that, but... They need to, WWE needs to realize that it's not working.
Yeah, somebody needs to.
It's not working.
Yeah,
it's not
when
working.
When Jen says that it's not working, it's
and this is a guy. This is a guy that had.
Go ahead.
I was gonna say this. Okay, real quick. This is a guy that I thought a month ago had Stone Cold Steve Austin level excitement around him with the crowd. Jen.
Oh, he did.
Yeah,
100%. But there. Just this whole lunatic fringe gimmick, it's stupid. When you had him with the Shield, he was badass. He was cocky. He was an asshole. And that's what drew people to him. And even when the Shield broke up, he was still cocky. He was still a badass. He hated Seth Rollins. And you could feel it, because you did too. And now they're making him look like a freaking bitch.
Yeah. And it's just not...
I'm not buying it anymore.
No.
I'm so crazy. I'm so crazy. I don't want to
watch a show and see someone I like get the shit beat out of them. Constantly. Oh my gosh, I sound like my dad.
That's all right. I'm getting called salty in the chat room.
This is, by the way, the angriest show we've had in a while.
I think when you are involved with a wrestling show, a wrestling podcast, you have to look at wrestling through a certain rose-colored glasses to put up, especially with the WWE, to put up with the WWE. You have to really go in and going, okay, I know this is going to be bad, but this is what I want to do. And it's like, when you're coming into it as somebody who doesn't watch it particularly all the time, and then every time they watch it, every time they go to a show, every time they see it, it's just like, oh, the potential is there.
Yes.
But you just like, look how awesome we are. And then you just derail the train into a wall. It's like so.
That's exactly what they've done with him.
Exactly. Oh, that's what they've done with the product in general.
Also, you guys haven't been on every week to get those frustrations out in trickles like we do. You're just hearing like, this is everything we have a problem with.
Right, yeah, so I want to hate everything.
Jen, Garza says, yes. Welcome to being a heel fan.
Sad Jen has face.
A sad face.
So since you guys, Riz...
Usually it's mainstream Matt that I bitch at.
I think he's going to be so proud when he hears this. Riz says, so since you guys aren't watching WWE anymore, are you going to watch TNA?
No.
Oh,
I'd Jen. Rather sell my soul to the devil than watch TNA.
Say, Jen, you've had your try at TNA.
I did. And I think I grew stupider by watching it.
Wow.
I lost brain cells.
Katie, back to your list.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Miz there. Versus Cesaro.
Mm-hmm.
My vote is Cesaro kills Miz.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, yes.
God, I hope Cesaro I'm so glad Cesaro's Miz back. And he knocks out his wife.
I like that plan.
Yes,
maybe he swings them both at the same time.
Now you guys have to admit, launches them. Like Miz and Cesaro has got to be some of the better stuff on the show right yeah, now. Well, consistently,
and that's the thing. Like Miz and Cesaro, I'm kind of excited about this. I'm Miz just runs his mouth.
Yeah,
but Miz can also bring it in the ring.
Yes,
when, but he's so good.
And that's just it.
He's
like,
taking second takes of his promos.
You are supposed to hate him, and I get that, which makes it, I think, that much better. I'm actually looking forward to the match.
You didn't feel bad when he got killed in Supernatural. Spoilers. That we watched this last week. So, out of order. I'm not even caught up, and we watched that because Miz was on it. So.
But yeah. But that is one good match. I'm excited about that one.
Yeah.
But I do think Cesaro. Really excited he's back.
Yes. Cesaro's amazing.
Now, this one.
Claudia Castagnoli.
This is a match I'm excited about. Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. I don't know.
I have mixed feelings on this one.
Really?
Yeah.
It could go good or it could go very bad.
Yeah, and I'm not sure which way it's going to go.
If this doesn't deliver, then there's no hope for main event booking. if these guys that have been doing this match and we want to see it every time for last like 10 years, if this doesn't go well on this platform, there's no freaking hope for this company.
There's a lot of build for this match.
Yeah, that's what my fear is that they're building it so much that by the time we get there, if it doesn't deliver, I'm going to be disappointed.
Mm-hmm. Or we're going to have it 20 times.
Yes, yeah. That's the other thing.
If this becomes a match that happens on SmackDown, then Raw the next week, then we're done.
They've done that before,
mm-hmm.
and it's, like you said, it's killed it.
Like really, the third time, like I can think AJ, Jericho, and Kalisto and Ryback is just buried in the ground because you're like, well, let's have it again. Well, let's have it again. But now this guy's mad. You know, I mean, it doesn't work. It's not enough change.
Moon chimes in that the KO versus Zayn should be good. So
yes, it should be because of the guys.
Involved. Exactly. Mm-hmm. It should be. We've seen them. We've seen them against each other. We've seen them with the build.
Maybe something will happen and they'll build to a ladder war next pay-per-view. Just saying.
I'm curious to see where they're going to go with it. It could be amazing. It could be lackluster. I'm hoping that it's amazing. On to the rest of the list.
Taya versus Charlotte.
And we got Bret Hart in the corner. How do you feel about Charlotte?
God, did this turn into like a Dr. Phil special? Just letting all my anger out?
Yeah, just go. Just let it out, girl. Feel those feels.
I hope Natty wins. 100%. I hope Ric Flair gets freaking knocked on his ass.
Payback should be renamed back to NXT because we have two matches from NXT, including all the way down to Bret in the corner with Ric Flair in the other corner for the first.
That did happen at a takeover.
Yeah, and I think they're doing that primarily because, hey, if you liked this over here, go check it out.
You're bringing the NXT people up.
Yep.
The fans were like, oh, just like they did at the end of the women's title tournament when Charlotte won the first title, you know, and that, you know, sure.
They're pandering to that cross crowd, trying to bring them over from NXT to the main roster because I think that's been a hard sell for people because people who've come up from NXT get lost in the main roster or they get misbooked and it's just a fiasco.
Well, here's a question. For everybody here that has followed a lot of this stuff from NXT to the main roster, I think a perfect example is Becky, Sasha, and Charlotte. Do you feel their feud, I don't want to say the entire feud because I think it's been kind of long and drawn out, but do you think their match at WrestleMania lived up to what you would expect from those three? And this is a discussion I haven't heard.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you guys feel about that? There, everybody saw that match, right?
I didn't see that match.
Oh, I was just waiting for Jen.
Jen?
I saw it.
Yeah. Did you feel like it lived up to their NXT matches?
No.
No.
I don't think so.
No.
I don't know. They're still trying to figure out how to translate that NXT intensity into the WWE ring.
Yeah, a little bit.
With the women, I think.
Well, and I think part of the difference is the crowd.
Yeah.
Crowd. Because.
And time.
And
the time given.
Yes. Yeah. Because I know the crowd at NXT, you've got smarks. I mean, they're familiar with the product. They're familiar with the cast of characters. And they know what to expect. And they put on a hell of a good show.
Mm-hmm.
When you bump them up to the main roster, you have all of the casual fans and all of the.
Yeah, but the casual fans are catching on.
They're catching on.
I mean, when Enzo and Cass walks out and they're on top of it, ole ole on everything.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think there's a difference anymore. I think enough of your casual fans, at least the ones that will pay a ticket for Raw, are very aware of NXT, hands down.
What is there the expectation? Like when I go to an NXT show, I'm expecting this.
I'm expecting this bar. When I go to a main roster show, I am not expecting that bar.
Managed expectations.
Is it? I mean, is that
not at all for myself to have been at Full Sail for 4 hours of taping? That was a shock in itself. It's a lot more intimate. Mm-hmm. It's smaller. You have your people there that go every. It's totally different. It's totally different.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think going back, I'm sorry, I'm going to go back to this match again. Talia and Charlotte, Natty and Charlotte. I think I like that Bret Hart is on the outside of the ring for this because I think Natty has. And I've been told I'm wrong every time I say this, but I'm going to say it anyways. I think she loses some credibility because her dad interferes a lot. But everybody loves Ric Flair. Everybody loves Ric Flair. I get that. We all love Ric Flair. That's fantastic. But I feel like...
I'd rather see Natty with her dad than Flair. Or than
Right. Dad's got some problems, unfortunately.
Have you saw Total Divas?
I know. We can show him with his problems on a reality show, but God forbid, take him to a pay-per-view.
Ric Flair is... just needs to walk away.
Yeah.
And I've said that before. But I think she's losing credibility as a wrestler because of him.
I agree, because he is stepping in. And it's not just like, you know, a tag team partner or mm-hmm. a friend stepping in. It's your dad. And with the push that they're making for the revolutionizing women's wrestling, having her dad in her corner, I think is just kind of backpedaling that. As far as the image it's portraying, because she relies on her dad to help cheat. Mm-hmm. Like exactly. I would buy it more credible if somebody else was in the ring, somebody else was in her corner, you know, like when she was with Sasha, you know, I would buy that more than I buy her dad. Just in general.
I think it's a booking mentality.
It's
a booking mentality. But great. There's another reason for us to use Ric Flair. That's great.
Yeah.
Just like when we super put over the heart connections with D.H. Smith and Mr. Natty.
Tyson Kidd.
Thank you. and threw her out there, you know, I mean, that's what they know to do because they're like, you know,
well, it's the obvious connection and I get that. But if I were Charlotte, I would be looking, and obviously, you know, I mean, she doesn't have the authority to tell them how they're going to book her, but I would look at it and say, hey, you know, I want to be doing this on my own. I've gotten this far on my own. I don't want to be relying on the fact that he is my dad.
And I think
I don't want to be relying on him.
I thought she did really good because there was definitely the animation, you know, it was there, but Charlotte was her own character in NXT.
Absolutely.
And I think this is the introductory phase to the fans. And I think her talent still sticks out, right? I think you'll get around to. I mean, eventually there'll be a split, and eventually Charlotte will evolve from beyond that.
I'm ready for that. Mm-hmm. I am so ready for that.
When as with that thing with WWE, it takes a little bit longer than what you're ready for.
And I'm hoping.
I'm not ready for it because it comes off as Ric Flair to me just reminds me of your drunk old grandpa is just a pervert.
Your dirty uncle in the corner.
Yeah, or the one that says inappropriate things all the time that you're just like, you just keep telling yourself, oh, he's just old. Oh, he's just old.
He comes from a different generation.
Yes.
You go over to your friend's house and their dad just gives you the creeps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's Ric Flair. That's what he's coming in. He's just, maybe not. Now that I think about it.
All right, here's a different take on it. Riz is commenting, the gimmick of Charlotte using her dad like her dad did using other people like a distraction shield is brilliant. I'm just worried Flair's not all there anymore.
The next one.
Eventually Rick will move on to another younger hottie. Thank you, Garza.
Do you have any other daughters?
Riz suggests Becky. Oh, all right.
Run, Becky, run.
Oh, God, just looking at.
All right. Jen is making herself.
Okay, we'll move on. Okay. Oh, the big discussion. Who's going to control Raw?
I think it's going to be Linda.
Oh, out of nowhere.
I think there's going to be an election. And we're all going to get the vote.
Linda's going to lose.
And Linda's going to lose again.
Oh.
After spending way too much money.
Oh. Too soon.
Well, last night on the Raw wrap-up, Mad Mike was insisting that it's draft time again. So,
yeah, I was curious about that.
I don't know if they need it, especially with the limited rosters. But if it means stuff like, hey, Damian Sandow could do something again. Sure.
Yeah.
I don't hate the idea. Maybe it's time again. Maybe this is just something they just cycle through and say, let's do this every once in a while, you know, and flesh out some of those NXT guys up and they don't get lost in the shuffle as bad. Yeah, because stretching those storylines out, SmackDown, I still enjoy more than Raw. But to say, hey, we put all our stuff on Raw. Cool. You know. I don't hate that. I just wonder what they're going to do with the titles now that they've consolidated everything again. But Did we just combine everything just to split it up, just like we did last time with the unified titles?
Oh, yeah. Like,
yeah, seriously.
Unified title.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I'm concerned about.
I think it could go either way. And
they don't even know what they're going to do.
No, they don't. No, absolutely creative don't.
Creative is locked in a room right now, and they're not allowed to leave until they come up with some really excellent ideas. Did we just...
Nothing happened. Don't worry about it.
What was that?
That was a non-essential plug.
What did you do?
Don't worry about it.
I'm scared.
I'm not putting my foot there again.
Okay. I was like, you did that. Oh, good.
Yes.
All right.
Sorg shock himself?
Yes. Sorg is just like sitting over there writhing behind the...
His hair just poofed.
Yep.
That's why you're not getting my camera.
He's kind of drooling.
All right. So we really don't care who takes over Raw is what I've just decided.
Yeah.
Because you know what? Whoever takes it over, it's going to be shit anyway.
Yeah. Do they have pets? Can their pets take it over? Do they have any...
Here's a hint. They don't actually book the show.
What? No, that's not
lies.
True. Lies. Why are you ruining this for me?
God, why don't you just tell me there's no Santa?
What?
Although I do want more Shane McMahon in the back. Good job, guys. Good job. Pat on the back. Good match, guys. Good job.
All right.
High five me, bro.
All right, let's go for the big one.
Roman
Reigns versus AJ Styles for the heavyweight champion.
Holy crap, this is actually happening.
What?
What? AJ Styles is actually in a title match.
Okay, well, I like that half.
Okay, yeah, that's okay. Part I like.
I mean, let's think about that, you know? Mm-hmm. And people say, when's Roman going to go heel? I'm like, guys, have you been paying attention? He kind of is not entirely a good guy anymore.
But he's the guy,
you know?
I'm not a good guy. I'm not a bad guy.
Now, okay. So, if we fully define heel, so he has to be a jerk, and the crowd has to hate him.
Yes. We're there.
We've been there since he got the belt.
We're there.
So, yeah, we're there. What are we gonna do with him now that he's there? Because is he... Do we like him as a heel? I mean, is this a good thing that he's
become a heel? I think Payback will solidify whatever we've been stepping into this past 4 weeks of Raw, right?
Maybe.
Stepping in, are we stepping in with the Rock smelling? The poop?
God, I hope so.
The poop? Do you smell
rock babies?
Rock babies? Okay. So we are excited about AJ.
Yes.
Very excited about AJ. And I really just vote AJ takes the title and Roman Reigns goes off on some sort of holiday with the Usos, with the ladybug sex.
Maybe they go to Puerto Rico.
That's okay. Cars commented that Reigns wins, AJ turns heel because reasons.
Ooh, I like reasons.
What was something else that we were talking about up here? Sorry, I was going back. We had some comments in the chat room a little bit ago that I should have popped over.
But there's go ahead, Jen.
When is Seth supposed to come back?
I don't know.
Who knows? Could be a payback time. And he's not been in much of the conversation, so he'd be a good one.
Ladybugs.
I mean, could the Shield reunite?
Jen, you need to hang up that hope and aspiration. It's just, it's not going to happen.
Only in the
I would love to see the Shield versus Balor Club or Bullet Club, whatever club
they are now.
I am excited because we have a main event title match with again a chance for high shenanigans that don't involve McMahons.
Yay!
Yes.
Or married in McMahons.
Ooh.
Although the stuff that Triple H has been doing on the European tour, I could watch that all day if it happened on Raw. If anybody's seen the minute long, the minute long sunset flip counter, yes. Is pretty fantastic. And I didn't realize at first that they put it to music. There's some good stuff happening with Triple H out there. He's having
it's magical.
It is magical. It's absolutely magical. Triple H is magic, and you know, is he.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm
done with magic.
Okay. Done magicking?
I thought you were off on a tangent that I couldn't control you from.
Magical tangent.
All right. Are we done with our payback?
Yep.
Okay. I want to get back to the discussion about the change from divas to women as far as the ladies are concerned. As indicated briefly earlier, I think it's amazing because there is a difference between a diva and a women's division wrestler. You know, it's the difference between Chyna and Brie Bella.
Yes, like Bella Twins.
Nikki Bella. They're divas.
Or Summer Rae.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They're divas. They are the pretty little foo-foos that try to wrestle. And
that just scream a lot.
Well, it's not necessarily that they scream a lot. I have no interest in watching the matches because there's not a lot of meat to it. It's more flair and pretty and
slapping.
Yeah.
Lana's a dancer.
Who's a dancer?
Lana.
Well, okay.
Is she a private dancer?
So how often do you see Lana in the ring?
She's wearing her dance clothes.
The European tour, she was in the ring.
Mm-hmm. Wearing her dance clothes.
And that's what I'm saying is you don't see her in the ring because that's not what she does. They're giving her some opportunity to see where it goes, I think. Mm-hmm. But
she's eye candy.
Exactly.
To me, Paige, Becky Lynch.
Yep.
Yep.
Naomi.
Yep.
Snuka.
Mm-hmm. Sorg is wagging his finger
on the eye candy because obviously she's got a thing. She's out there and people were chanting "We want Lana," even though they got her, she was there, right? I find her less intriguing now that she's not coming out in full business attire.
Yeah, that's weird.
Like now that she's coming out and showing some skin and cleavage, you're like, okay, she's just another girl.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know. And, I mean, there's no Rusev Crush and stuff like that. Like there was something different. There's something interesting. It was a character. Now she looks like the rest of the girls for the most part. So she needs to do something, whether it be in the wrestling or be something else to actually stick out.
Well, Sheep commented that Charlotte, Becky and Sasha raised the bar so high that most of the divas can't keep up.
Mm-hmm.
And I agree with it. And I absolutely love it because that's one of the things that I loved. When I stopped watching wrestling for quite a while, just because I hated the product. It was just ridiculous BS that I just didn't enjoy watching.
Mm-hmm.
I would occasionally watch it with Sorg here or there. I would see something that just irritated me and I would just go to bed or, you know, walk away or whatever. NXT came around and he was all, seriously, Missy, you need to check this out. You need to try this. One of the things that I loved was the ladies, because it was legit ladies wrestling. It wasn't the bra and panties matches. It wasn't the, you know, foo-foo stuff that we had there. It wasn't somebody doing dance moves in the ring trying to make it work type of thing. It was legit wrestling. You know, maneuvers, takedowns, they didn't pull punch. Literally, they didn't pull punches. I mean, instead of pulling hair, they were punching type of stuff. When they came over to the main roster, I was super excited. The fact that we've had ladies matches as main events it speaks profoundly, because that never would have happened.
They were the center of the banner on AT&T station.
Exactly.
Stadium.
Which is a huge thing. And it's amazing. It's amazing because that's never happened. If you've had any focus placed on the women's match before, it's all been because of the, hey, the divas are going to be half naked, or they're going to be doing this, or they're going to be doing that. And it's not been in any aspect. They're center stage because it's going to be a legit match. And I think it's awesome. Katie?
Sorry. I was looking at something else. I apologize. I think, like, discussing the divas to the women's, it's... I'm excited that it's women's now, and please just keep supporting it as women's and don't dumb it down. I don't know. Like, I feel like, this is something we've asked for, and I'm so afraid the WWE is going to keep letting us down with it. Please just give us.
Because that's what they do.
Yes, please. Well, please make me stop being a better WWE fan. I want to like you. I want to support things, but please just stop kicking me in the crotch. That's what I feel like. You're like, you can do it, then. Poof.
Well, maybe
it's a bad relationship.
Yes.
Oh my God, yes.
It's a bad romance.
You give, you give, you give. And they give you back, and you're like, oh, you're not so bad. Yes. And then they screw you over.
Mm-hmm.
Moon put in the chat room, do you think AJ Lee would have been good with the three top female wrestlers? I think that AJ Lee would be awesome with this group of ladies that are in there right now, because she's, again, one of those ones that I felt could legit wrestle and do some shit, and just didn't have anybody to really have that opportunity with the Divas. Mm-hmm.
I think when things became the Bella Show,
it went downhill.
And I understand why it became the Bella Show, because how do you sell a reality show if you don't have...
If you don't have something to back it.
Mm-hmm.
I
don't like these business moves. I mean, I understand the business moves.
I understand them, but they're not...
It doesn't mean I like them.
No. And this is coming from women. Obviously, they're pitting the Bellas for, I would think, the...
And yet, it's worked, though, because we have even just anecdotally heard of girls getting into wrestling. Mm-hmm. Isn't there, who was it? Jeez, where was it? There was somebody who is training. Somebody was just telling me about recently. They're going to train because they started watching Total Divas. Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. Wrap your head around that one. It's an introduction, or people that have watched Total Divas and then started watching Raw.
Okay.
It is a jumping on point. It is somewhere where you're like, well, I'm not going to go to the USA because I know that's that weird wrestling stuff. You're going through watching E, you get introduced to this. Cause what do you do? What do you do when you watch reality shows? You watch shows of people that do something different than you. Right. The Kardashians or Dirty Jobs or Myth, people in other professions, dance moms or something like that, right? And you get a look into that world. That's what Total Divas is doing, and again, is that entry point, and that's why there's that crossover between the two.
Well, if it can stop disappearing over here.
Bobby?
Yeah. Bobby posted, AJ, Paige, Emma, Sasha, Becky, Charlotte, Caitlin, Asuka, Bailey, Naomi, Natalia. Imagine a roster with all those names.
And I'm imagining WrestleMania 35.
Yeah, I'm thinking that's right around the corner. I mean, that is attainable within my lifetime, within the next decade.
Look at WrestleMania. Exactly. Look at how many people there weren't there but a year ago.
Exactly. The fact that we can still have the differentiation between what we're titling divas and lady wrestlers, women's wrestlers. As much as you just indicated about the Total Divas show being a gateway into wrestling, I understand and I agree where you came from with that. And I'm glad that it's worked for that purpose. What I'm not a fan of is them booking the Bellas as this huge thing on the main roster just to keep that going. And don't even get me started on the push that they're trying to make for what's her name that I don't like? All Red.
Oh, Eva Marie.
Yes. Shut up, Garza.
Of course.
Missy's mad.
I despise her. The fact that they are trying to make her as big as the next Bella thing, I'm just like, go away. You have amazing women wrestlers. Utilize them. Focus on them. They're beautiful. They're amazing. They're strong. They're awesome. Why, for the love of God, do you keep trying to shove Eva Marie down my throat?
Because her hair is very red.
I just, oh.
Because she looks great in Maxim.
So what?
Because she's all red everything.
Because we don't have Playboy anymore.
Well, here's my thing. What's the difference between her doing that shoot versus Becky Lynch doing that shoot?
I think she's more Maxim than Becky Lynch. Yeah. Is the thing, too.
Looking through her Instagram feed.
You know,
she's legit over here looking through the Instagram feed. Yeah,
I mean, no, I mean, she's more modelly than, I mean, certainly than Becky Lynch. Not that they couldn't do it or anything.
That's exactly it. She's more modelly.
Yeah.
She's not wrestlery. She's modelly. She's modelly trying to do wrestlery thing to open the door for other things.
No, they made a mistake. They made a mistake bringing her in too quick, too. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I'm totally
not. They made the mistake even signing her.
Oh. Oh, no.
So, Katie, what are your thoughts?
Oh, look, I'm going to learn how to contour my face. Look, she has one of her Instagram video photos is a link to her YouTube channel telling you how to contrast your face with makeup.
This is me bashing my head off of something non-existent.
Sorry, I was too good to look at, not look at. I don't know.
Okay, are you avoiding the question? Is that what's happening?
Yes, I'm contouring my face. Leave me alone.
Okay.
Cheekbones.
Ugh. All right. That part of the conversation just broke me. Sorg, where are we on time?
I don't know. I'm mesmerized for all the wrong reasons on her Instagram right now. It's time to go to the break. I'm going to see what's going on. Katie actually lets us know how the Mayhem Show has influenced her.
Oh, man.
Looking for group at the 10-year party.
Worst experience ever.
And we'll be back with our friends looking for group, Pittsburgh. And we'll be back with the big question.
My circle of interest has expanded beyond, in regards to wrestling, it has expanded beyond the professional WWE world. I do have an interest in going to indie shows. I have an absolute blast, and I suggest it to anyone who hasn't been to one to go. I've made some really, really good friends, surprisingly, who are just slightly more weird than I am. I mean, a little more weirder. I think I'm the most normal of the group, obviously.
Thank you for coming back to the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 517, following that wonderful little video. That was Katie's video, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So following...
I need to correct that I was not saying it was awful at looking for a group. I was saying my first episode of Wrestling Mayhem Show was awful. Thank you.
Much like the 517th episode of Wrestling Mayhem Show?
Correct.
Okay.
Every episode I'm on is terrible.
Just wanted to throw that out.
All terrible. All
right. Well, ladies, I think it's time for the big question. And the big question this week, keeping everything in tune with our Chyna theory, is what is your defining memory of Chyna?
Jen, what's yours?
I would say back at No Mercy in Cleveland when she took on Jeff Jarrett for the IC title. And she went at it and won, and that was great.
I liked, was it the Royal Rumble 99 that she was in? I think it was the 99 Royal Rumble, and she picked up that very tiny gentleman, Mark Henry, and put him over top of those very short ropes and just amazed the shit out of me. I was like, this is amazing. Yes, that's one of my defining moments, is whenever she tossed out Mark Henry. Goodbye, sexual chocolate.
Yes. I love that you guys are actually sharing legit wrestling memories of Chyna. My defining memory of Chyna was when I actually... This is how much I appreciated Chyna. When she was in Playboy, I went and I purchased a Playboy for Sorg with Chyna. Best wife ever.
You did. I think you purchased for me like many of the WWE WWE girls in Playboy editions that I have.
I think I did too.
Yes, yes. The ultimate fandom there.
Yes.
Do you have the HBK one?
No, that's Playgirl, and I know.
Did you buy it for your wife?
Yeah. What is this, Sorg? What kind of...
I think that's before...
It's a double standard.
I don't think either of us were old enough to purchase that at the time.
Excuse me?
Were we?
What?
Would we have been? That was like 96.
I didn't even know you then.
There's that too. Mm. There's that too.
Maybe it was someone else who purchased it. Oopsie.
Now that we've gone off on a completely different tangent, we'll get back to the legit stuff. Wheels actually commented that his defining memory of Chyna is when she was hugging Marlena. Bobby F. J-Town, the whole thing with Eddie and Chyna was the best.
Mamacita. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Oh my god, that was hysterical. I love that.
Spin. That whole thing. That's my favorite too. Just him courting her and everything was just the best.
Well, see, and that's the thing. Like that is my defining moment. Like that was my favorite moment with Chyna. That and the mooning.
Oh my gosh.
Those two moments. But I figured people would say those. Not everybody's going to say that they bought their significant other the Playboy. Riz having Kat be her mini-me.
Also great.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I love that.
Heel Garza, when Chyna helped Kurt Angle versus Jarrett and Karen Jarrett.
Is that a TNA thing?
Garza.
I'm guessing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would assume so, but I don't know. So yeah, it goes to show. There are a lot of different things involved with Chyna's history with the WWE. You know, and the fact that we all have these awesome, amazing memories to share.
It was TNA.
Ah, yes. It just goes to show what sort of an impact she's had on wrestling. Not just women's wrestling, but wrestling in general. And the fact that we all have some awesome, fun stuff to share is really cool.
I would just like to say that you can purchase the Playgirl magazine from October 1996 with Shawn Michaels in it for $37.99 on eBay. So, Sorg, you have a chance to redeem yourself.
That's good to know. It's good to know.
You might want to pass that along to Larry as well.
Well, there you go. There you go.
Yeah, look at this guy. Look at him. He's wearing a towel. Woo! Harry Manchester.
Auntie has hair.
Look, he's got hair.
He is a sexy boy.
This heartbreak kid is single, sexy, and waiting to get wet with you. Yay! Woo! Win ringside seats. Holy crap. Look, you could have won ringside seats.
And I never will now because Sorg didn't buy me this.
Way to go, Sorg.
Apparently.
Sorg, ruiner of all fun things.
I just want to read the article. Can I get a copy of the article? Does anybody have a copy? Articles? Of the Playgirl.
Jen, do you have a copy?
I may.
Jen is quiet.
Ooh, look at this on this tripod website. Yes! Yes, I found it.
Sean's Playgirl interview.
Yep. Thank you, Tripod. hbkfans.tripod.com. Interview from Playgirl magazine.
Which seems appropriate.
Yes.
So didn't you just come across your tripod page?
Somebody sent me my tripod page from 2001 for it because they're looking for a band I reviewed, apparently. All right.
So apparently tripod is still a thing.
Yep. Yep.
Is that like MySpace?
No. Jen,
I just want to pat you on the head right now.
Yes.
You're adorable.
Yes.
Thank you, dear. pat yourself on the head for me. And another one for Katie. And just pinch your cheek for Sorg. Other cheek, dear. Other cheek.
Okay, the next gold segment we're going to record will be me reading the interview from Playgirl magazine.
So much gold.
Hey, the Ladies of Mayhem give our Patreon subscribers
what they want.
Plenty of gold.
Hey, I'm paying for this shit.
Yep, and she wants me to read this. Yep. Okay, let's close out the show so I can start reading my interview.
Wonderful. Okay, we already did our Mad Mike mail. Did you guys just want to... Do you guys have anything else to add for wrestling that you want to talk about? Or do you just want to head into our what we learned this week?
I already said what I learned this week. I learned that I can't stand listening to Dean Ambrose and Jericho.
And I've already said I'm sick of Ambrose looking like a weenie.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there you go.
So, yep. Sorg, what did you learn this week?
What did I learn this week? Well, I'll tell you what. Jeez. I learned I can't interview people before wrestling shows because they're completely in character, as you guys will find out at Indie Mayhem Show in a couple of, what are these pictures? In a couple of weeks here. The chat room is getting weird. From the Facebook, though, we had a few answers. And first of all, Bobby of J-Town learned that Cesaro should be the new James Bond and face Batista in the next movie.
Yes.
Kiko says that Hiroshi Tanahashi is like something out of a nightmare dressed like Chun-Li. What?
Whoa.
Okay. Mad Mike, who was at Poughkeepsie NXT, learned to mourn the loss of an air guitar. Alex Carr is out there in California, learned that WWE Creative can do good feud every once in a while. Case in point, Zayn Owens' feud is so natural that it doesn't need a title and is befitting of the pay-per-view named Payback. Joseph says he wants a full episode of Monday Night Raw. He watched the full episode of Monday Night Raw last night for the first time in forever, all 3 hours. And what he learned is that wrestling this week is that some people are wrong about 3 hours of Monday Night Raw being boring after 90 minutes. I enjoyed the hell out of it last night. So there you go. There's somebody on the other side of things. We were a little rough on it last night on the Raw wrap up, and obviously you guys were as well. So
yeah.
So there you go.
Aw, thank you, Garza. Garza learned that this all-women show is the best WMS since Monkey Rodeo. Sorg, time to pass the torch.
Yes.
That's okay, Garza, because if you weren't here early on in the show, Sorg was pretty much giving Katie and I the keys to the kingdom to do a Ladies of Mayhem podcast ourselves.
There you go. There you go. Do you want to see it? Do you guys want to see a Ladies of Mayhem ongoing show spinoff? Let us know. GoodTimesAtWrestlingMayhemShow.com, for instance,
we could be like the Total Bellas.
There you go.
Shut your whore mouth.
Oh, please don't even. Jen is not on our show.
No. You just banned yourself for life.
I'm kidding.
You don't look like you were kidding.
You know what I think would be good? Remember going to Columbus in the car?
Yes.
There were some fun times.
That was fun. How else would we have gotten to Columbus?
That's true.
And with that, thank you for tuning in to the Ladies Takeover Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Yes.
Thank you to our Patreons. Thank you to Sorg.
Yeah, have at it. Maybe we'll do this more often. Or every week.
Are you surprised that we're wrapping up early?
No, I don't know about this as early. But I think it was a good time, and people seem to enjoy it in the chat room. And again, let us know. Let us know.
Good times.
Your thoughts.
At WrestlingMayhemShow.com.
Go check out everything WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to the show in whatever format, including now Google Play. Mm-hmm. If you can find podcasts, you can find this show there. And please do there. Give us a bump. Any podcast you're listening to, please give them a bump for that as well. 412-206-WMS0 or goodtimesatwrestlingmayhemshow.com. Support us on patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow, as we mentioned probably a few times by now. And check everything else out. Thanks to 405media.com for hosting us for the live streaming. Or not the live streaming, but have us in rotation over there throughout the week. So please go check them out. They support us. Support them back. And everything else going on at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com, about 8 p.m. Eastern time for about 3-ish hours of pro wrestling talk. Ladies, at Kay Dudders on the Twitter. She does a lot of stuff. She's also on the Awesome Cast and the Scarehouse Podcast. You can look up all those. Jen Carlins. This is Jen Carlins on the Twitter. She has fantastic photos of Dean Ambrose.
And that's just about it. That's all she takes pictures of is Dean Ambrose.
A lot going on there. Great photography, actually, if you look up some of her older stuff of like any Raws or pay-per-views or anything. She really gets up in there.
I have more pictures than Ambrose.
I know. And Missy at Life of the Show on the Twitters. And she's usually the one tweeting for us throughout the nights here. On Tuesday night podcast day. I'm Sorg. Hi, I've been a little quiet. At Sorgatron on the Twitter, SorgatronMedia.com for this, and some familiar face out in the wilderness with Sawtooth Willie. And we did talk about pro wrestling on Fishing Without Bait this week. FishingWithoutBait.com. A little bit different. some of you guys like it. Check it out. And we'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.